So remember, the setting is they're on their way to Jerusalem. Jesus, the 12 apostles, and verse 35 tells us that then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him saying, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask." He said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" They said to him, "Grant us that we may sit one on your right hand and the other on your left in your glory." Now, you've heard that expression, there's a time and a place. And it is striking, isn't it, that after Jesus has basically just said, "I'm going to Jerusalem, I'm going to be betrayed, suffer," all the things he outlined for us that we looked at, "and I'm going to be put to death." Yes, he promised that he would rise again, but at the same time, here they are, say, "Okay, well, when you get through all that, in your glory," you know, I mean, it's just not really an appropriate time to ask on this journey. Now, we don't know how many minutes or hours had passed from one to the next, but still, the idea of even bringing it up at all is something indeed. And Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" Now, we know that Jesus referred to the cross as his cup that he had to drink. There in the garden, you know, he prayed, "Father, if it possible, let this cup pass from me." He was speaking about the cross, which was just hours away. So for him to talk about, "Are you able to drink the cup that I drink?" You can see the connection to his suffering, to his sacrifice, his death. And then likewise, to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with. Now, that's a kind of a trickier thing. I guess different people have different ideas of what he means. But remember, baptism at its core, and I always say this whenever the word comes up in Scripture, the main word to think of behind the whole process of baptism, what it's about, what the Greek letters and the origins counted for, and all the rest of it, is the word identification. And so with that as a starting point, there is a sense, isn't it, that he's still talking about the cross. You know, that identification. Jesus suffered. He was rejected. He was an outcast. He was even put to death. Can you be identified with that, James and John? Drinking of the cup that I drink of. They said to him, verse 39, "We are able." It must have been one of those things like they know, well, you know, he's expecting a yes here. Let's, you know, we're able. But truly, they don't fully understand what they're saying. And I'm not trying to be overly critical or hard on these great men, but it's just the reality, isn't it? They don't. But Jesus knows not only what awaits him in the future, but awaits them in the future. And so continuing in verse 39, Jesus said to them, "You will indeed drink the cup that I drink, and with the baptism I am baptized with, you will be baptized." They are going to suffer, aren't they? For their faith in Jesus Christ and for no other reason. Now this James that we saw here is the brother of John. This is not the James that later we read about who wrote the book of James, for example, or is a big leader in the church of Jerusalem in the book of Acts. This is the James that actually is put to death very early in the history of church. Stephen, of course, is the first recorded martyr for Jesus Christ in the book of Acts. James is second. He was put in jail. He was killed by Herod with the sword. He truly did drink of the cup, didn't he? That Jesus, he suffered and he died for obedience to the will of the Father, for his allegiance to Jesus. Now, John was not martyred, but it wasn't for a lack of trying. The enemies of God tried to kill John. He was sent out as an outcast. He suffered tremendously, but he managed to live a long life by God's grace. And clearly God had a purpose and a reason for John living such a long life, because we know John would be used by the Lord to write so much of the New Testament, specifically the Gospel of John, those three letters that we have, those epistles, and the book of Revelation itself. But he suffered. All of the disciples, those initial ones, suffered. So Jesus said, you will. Even though they said, oh, we're able, and they don't have any idea what's waiting them in the future, but Jesus says, you will. But then he goes on in verse 40 to say, but to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it is prepared. We know, and we talk often about the fact that God sees everything that happens in our lives, and he's keeping records. And we will stand before God to account for our lives, but again, not our sins. Our sins are put away by the sacrifice of Jesus. Hallelujah. As far as the east is from the west, our sins are just cast away. But we give an account of our lives before God. What did we do with this incredible gift? And God will reward how we used our lives. Now, when I was growing up through like middle school, high school, we would have those award days. Sometimes they were academic in nature, you know, and sometimes they were athletic. I played a lot of sports. And I can remember a couple times winning an award that I didn't think I was going to win, you know. I mean, I was shocked. And the winner was Steve Wright. Like, really? You know, you go up and... Now, if you're surprised at the award you just won, that means there's probably someone in the crowd that's disappointed because there's always a favorite, right? There's always, oh, yeah, this one, I'm probably going to win. And then they don't have their name called out. Oh, I've been in that position too, by the way. What? He won it instead of me? What causes a reaction like that? Pride, ego, right? But just think about heavenly glory. Can you imagine how marvelous it'll be to have God reward you for things that you can't even possibly imagine, you never dreamed were coming? Really, Lord? You know, like, oh yeah, that was a big deal in my sight. You know, wow. But the flip side is also a reality as well. Well, I'm sure the Lord, you know, took note of all that and find out, oh, you know, you got your reward on earth. There was no heavenly value to that action, to that accomplishment, to those words or that giving or whatever it might be. And that would be kind of disappointing. So when we think about sitting on the left hand and the right hand in glory, I mean, that's such an honor. We might, on the one hand, think that's got to be, you know, Paul and Peter, probably, right? You know, I mean, just kind of think like, who are the two biggies, you know? Or going throughout church history, I mean, there are some very significant individuals, men and women alike, throughout the history of the church, where when you try to tell a 2,000-year church history in, you know, in a book maybe this big, they get a whole chapter because they were so significant and they're well-known names. And I just wonder if the ones in this place of honor, when it actually comes to pass, won't be two people that none of us have any idea and have never heard of. Maybe. Because God sees things differently than we do, doesn't he? But I know what Jesus says about how you can, shall I say, you know, improve those chances of not being shocked, but rather being surprised and in awe at what God says to you in that day. Jesus explains how as we continue reading. But first, verse 41 tells us, that when the 10 heard it, so you remember, you got the 12 apostles, right? James and John are two of those, so you got 10 left. When the 10 heard it, they began to be greatly displeased with James and John. They heard that James and John had asked for this favor. We don't see why they were displeased. Maybe they were upset that they asked first. I was going to ask tomorrow after lunch, you know? They beat me to it. But in any event, a little discord in the ranks a little bit. And Jesus called them all and is going to use it as a teachable moment. A teachable moment, not just for those 12, But as I said, for all of us, and this is where I go back to what he's going to say here. Hey, we saw stuff about marriage and divorce, children, riches. This is something that every one of us has a connection to. Verse 42, Jesus called them to himself and said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. Hey, in the unbelieving, ungodly, Gentile world of the Roman Empire in that day, there's no question who has all the power, who has all the authority. Those are the guys everyone's bowing to. They're like, yes, sir. I mean, it's very clear. Boy, those guys have the power, and they know it, and they lord it over those underneath them. That's the way the world works, Jesus said. Verse 43, yet it shall not be so among you. But whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. One thing we know, that anyone who's trying to get at the left hand or the right hand in glory there, be a slave of all. And yes, it's the word slave. It's meant to be a powerful, emotional word. A slave has no choice over their life. They just do whatever the master tells them to do. And on earth, the master-slave relationship may be an abomination, but it was a reality, a fact of history, and something that God uses as an illustration for our lives unto God. It's not like an employer-employee where, you know, well, I put in my 8 hours today, God. I mean, the other 16 are mine to do what I want. That's not how a slave experiences life. Every minute of every day, the master could call them to do something, and they would respond. Even things like eating, sleeping, or whatever were under the will. And that's our lives, to be under the will of God. And if we're under the will of God, serving God, then we will serve one another. And that's what Jesus is teaching in a very simple and yet profound way. And whenever he teaches anything about how we should live our lives, we are reminded that Jesus himself modeled it in his own life, didn't he? And he reminds them of that in verse 45. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. That powerful statement. That verse right there serves as the theme verse of the entire Gospel of Mark. Right there. You can highlight it, circle it, memorize it, whatever. That's the key verse right there. And it serves as the key moment, its placement there, that really divides the Gospel of Mark into two sections. Now, Mark's got 16 chapters, but you don't divide it, you know, 8 chapters here and 8 chapters there, like you're dividing a loaf of bread. The idea is what's covered, the content, and the reality is that for all of the first, you know, 9 and almost 10 full chapters there, what we have seen in the life of Jesus covered in Mark's gospel is the life of a servant. We have seen him serving others. It's very deliberate. You notice that Mark doesn't have those long sermons of Jesus. I mean, there's a lot of teaching, yes. But, for example, in Matthew, we've got the Sermon on the Mount. It's like 3 whole chapters, nothing but red letters, right? All that instruction. Mark leaves those teachings out. He's not presenting Jesus in that way, presenting him as the servant. So we see Jesus on the move all the time, responding. Even though he's doing incredible miracles, he's showing his authority over things like the storms, diseases, other infirmities, you know, blindness, deafness. He's showing authority over the demons and is showing authority even over the grave itself, raising people from the dead. But we still see him acting as a servant in those cases, don't we? Sometimes he's just trying to take a break, getting a little rest. Lord, I need you, please. You know, someone's dying, please help him. And there he is, serving over and over again. even though he's the Lord God Almighty, he's the King of the universe, and yet he didn't come to this earth to be served, but to serve. And then, as I said, this is the dividing point, because notice the second part, and to give his life a ransom for many. Because even though Mark does only have 16 chapters, isn't it fascinating that basically from this point on, the rest of the Gospel of Mark is what? Those final days of Jesus' life up to the cross. We're going to see next week, chapter 11, you know, Palm Sunday, what we call Palm Sunday, when he enters into Jerusalem on the donkey. This is to give his life a ransom for many. He served, and now the final act of service is actually to give his life. Now, you may recall elsewhere in the Bible, we read about Jesus' life was a ransom for all. And here it says, for many. That goes to what we were just talking about during the communion time of our service. When he died on the cross, it was a ransom for all people who have ever lived, the entire world. But as I said, for it to be meaningful, for it to have actual value for the individual, then that individual must personally trust Jesus. And so many people will trust Jesus, so there's a sense that his life is a ransom for all, but there's also a sense that his life is only a ransom for the many who actually believe him. And if we were to break down the actual original Greek of the New Testament, that would be even clearer. As little prepositions that are used there, even though it seems like the same words in English, except one says many and one says all, but actually what the Greek expresses is, on the one hand, when he died for all, it's a preposition that speaks of sufficiency. When he died for the many, it's a preposition that speaks of efficiency, or more literally, in the place of. He died in the place of those who would believe, the many who do. And may that many include all of us in this room today. Amen. This is the dividing point, as I said. Now, there's a few more verses in this chapter, and I do want to cover them today, and we'll start chapter 11 next week. But it's another act. It's the final miracle that Jesus performs that's public. Now, we're going to see a cursing of a fig tree a little bit later, but in terms of the public miracle, a miracle once more of healing, but I think that in addition to the literal details of the miracle, there's maybe even a deeper point that's here. So let's look at it. Verse 46. Now, they came to Jericho. So they're almost into Jerusalem now. And as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great multitude, notice the crowds are building. It's not just the 12 anymore, as he's getting closer and closer to Jerusalem. A great multitude are there. Blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the road begging. I bet the original readers of Mark back in the first century would probably know the name or the family of Bartimaeus and Timaeus for it to be listed like that. The name's kind of lost on us today, but to have that specific laid out for us. Once more, a reminder, these are real people. This is real history. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Here's this blind guy sitting by the roadside where people will come and go, and his life is one of desperation, because if you're blind, you certainly couldn't work in those days, and there's no government program, there's no private charities. The only charity there is the charity in a human heart that might be touched by God to maybe give you a little bit of money so that you can eat that day. He's a beggar. And normally, you might have a person or two come by on the road from time to time, but we've got this entourage. We've got this huge crowd of people. And he knows that there's something going on, because all the feet and everything, is hearing all this. And, who's going? That's Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. And no doubt at this point, he had heard about Jesus. And he hears that Jesus of Nazareth is coming by. So he cries out, son of David, Jesus, have mercy on me. He can't, being blind, he can't get up and run to Jesus like sometimes we see other people who need healing. They go right to Jesus and say, can you help me, Lord? He's just crying out. And many, verse 48, warned him to be quiet. Would you be quiet? Come on. But he cried out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. Can you imagine maybe the desperation in his heart? Because he knows what Jesus can do. And here's his chance. He's right kind of in the vicinity, but he's walking by. In a few minutes, he'll be far away, and my opportunity is lost. So he keeps crying out. People say, would you be quiet? And he keeps crying out. And as Jesus walking, Jesus, Nazareth, Son of David, have mercy on me. And he heard that. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. Go get that guy, bring him over here. They called the blind man, saying to him, be of good cheer, rise, he's calling you. And throwing aside his garment, he rose, came to Jesus, and Jesus answered and said to him, what do you want me to do for you? The blind man said to him, Rabboni. Now that's not just like another word of rabbi or something. No. Rabboni is a different word, and the idea is great one, this idea of emphasizing. He's not just calling him a teacher. It's great one, and you might have a footnote that mentions that. That I may receive my sight. And then Jesus said to him, go your way, your faith has made you well. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus on the road. While again, the details are certainly, historical and laying it out for us, I think that maybe, especially positioned where it is in Mark's gospel, kind of a deeper possibility for us as we read, because you just see this guy's condition. It's our condition. It's the world's condition. We are spiritually blind. And we cry out to the Lord. And sometimes we have to keep crying out. We may not seem to get an answer. Lord, are you there? But the Lord is there. And the Lord does respond to the cries of those who cry out, what? Have mercy on me. He didn't say, heal my blindness, pay my mortgage, give me a job, have mercy on me. That was his request. And then Jesus said, now what do you want me to do? And then he got specific, says, Lord, I want my sight. And Jesus gave him sight. And what was his response? Immediately, he followed Jesus. A little different than that rich young ruler from earlier in the chapter, right? Immediately he followed. And that should be our response as well, shouldn't it? It starts out by recognizing that we are blind and only Jesus can give us any kind of sight. Lord, have mercy on me. And when he opens our eyes and we begin to see things with the vision that God has, we see ourselves clearly, sinners that we are, our need for mercy and grace. We see God in a whole new way. We see this world as God sees it. Yes, it's full of sin, wickedness, evil, unrighteousness. We could go on and on, but it's also lost. Jesus saw those crowds. You remember, he was moved because they were like sheep with no shepherd. And to follow Jesus on the way, as Jesus would say elsewhere, where I am, there my servant will be. And to live our lives in such a way as to serve one another. God will guide, he will direct, and he will remember, rest assured. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this time in your word. May we go forth as doers of the word, not just hearers only. May we be challenged by what you have said to us, Lord, in the pages of scripture here. And may the Holy Spirit be speaking to each individual heart in this room today about our lives, about our relationships, about our situations. Give us eyes to see the need and opportunities to serve that need, so that we do so in a way that all the glory goes to you, Lord. For you are worthy of it all. We pray In the precious name of Jesus, amen.